Good morning and happy Easter to everyone today. I'm going to start out with reading two or three verses here this morning. Matthew chapter 20, verses 17 through 19. And Jesus, going up to Jerusalem, took the 12 disciples apart in the way and said unto them, Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death, and shall deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify, and on the third day he shall rise again. John chapter 2, verse 19, Jesus answered and said unto them, Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Mark chapter 8, verse number 31. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and of the chief priests and scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. Glorious morn, glad Easter day, when Christ arose from the grave, He shed his blood, my soul to save. He is the life, the truth, the way. He gave his life to ransom all, for all our sinners through the fall. But now God's children we can be, all because of Calvary. He died to save, he rose to keep, all his precious blood-washed sheep. Accept him now, be saved today. Rejoice, be glad this Easter day. Joining us here this morning on Easter day, Easter morning, Resurrection Sunday. What a glorious day it is. And I praise God for His love, for His grace, for His mercy, for His Son Jesus, who willingly went to that cross, having His hands and feet pierced, having died on that cross for me and for you. Pay the price for our sins. And praise God for the resurrection of His Son, Jesus Christ. Happy Easter to everyone. Again, thank you for being here with us. Wherever you are watching this, I would encourage you to take your Bibles, if you would, please. And we're going to look at the Word of God here in Matthew chapter number 28 this morning. Matthew chapter 28. And we're going to be looking at the first 8 verses in Matthew chapter number 28. Verses 1 through 8 here again as we are here on Easter morning celebrating the glorious resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter number 28, starting with verse number 1. Follow along with me, if you would, please. Matthew 28, verse 1. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the woman, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee, and there shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. Let's bow before the Lord this morning in a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you that we can bow before you in prayer wherever we may be. Call upon your name, lift our voices to you, and what a joy it brings to know that you are listening. All the things going on in the world, all the different events taking place, Father, you are not too busy to listen to our prayers whenever we humble ourselves and bow before you. So we thank you for that. I thank you, Lord, that we can celebrate this morning the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. That we can praise you for him, for that great sacrifice, for him dying on the cross, and for him raising again on the third day. We thank you for that. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for the gift of salvation. We thank you for Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. We are here today. You are watching today. And we are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. On an Easter morning like none we have ever experienced before. This is unlike anything any of us have ever been through. I'm sitting here looking at an empty church, and it's very strange. I can picture the faces of all the people here, the family, our church family. I can picture each one of you, and I miss you terribly. But here we are, again, celebrating, although it may be different, celebrating the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as we are here today, celebrating this morning like we've never done before, like we've never experienced before, it brings to mind that very first Easter morning as those first followers of Jesus were going through a time in their lives like they had never experienced before. Just a week earlier, they had followed Jesus into Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday. They had followed him in as he rode the donkey into town, as the palm leaves were put before him, rolling out the red carpet, praising his name as he is entering into Jerusalem. And those early followers, those disciples of Christ, followed him in, and they witnessed all of that 1 week ago. Then, as the week went on, they watched their leader, they watched their mentor, they watched their master be betrayed by Judas, one of their own. They watched their leader, their master, Jesus, be beaten and scourged, a crown placed upon his head, people mocking him, people spitting upon him. Those early followers watched as their leader was nailed to a cross and crucified. They watched as Jesus died on that cross. And they saw his body be placed in the tomb. Those early followers of Jesus, all those years ago, just prior to that first Easter morning, they found themselves facing so much uncertainty in their lives, so much uncertainty about their future, what was going to come next, what was going to happen next. There was so much uncertainty surrounding them in their lives, much like for us today, in this time that we are facing. In these circumstances here, so much uncertainty. We're not sure how all of this is going to play out. And there's a lot of uncertainty surrounding us today, as it was those early followers back then. They found themselves huddled away in hiding, hiding from those in authority, hiding from those Roman soldiers who they had just seen to take their leader, their master Jesus, drag him from the garden, put him on those in those false trials, and beat him and crucify him. They saw that, and they were hiding away from those same soldiers. They were huddled away from those in authority, because they didn't know what was going to happen to them. They didn't know if that may happen to them as well. So they were huddled away together in these small little rooms, much like we find ourselves today. You, shelter in place in your living room, or your kitchen, or your back porch, wherever you may be today. They found themselves in a similar situation. Back then, those early followers, they found themselves in desperate times where hope was hard to come by. Boy, I tell you, that sounds familiar to us today. Especially if you spend a lot of time watching the news or listening to the media or scrolling through social media. And we see these things and the things that's going on, the things that are surrounding us now. And these are desperate times where, if we allow it, it seems that hope is very hard to come by. Those early followers of Jesus, they found themselves in a place that they had never been before, not knowing what was going to happen next. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? And so they were going through a very tough trial, a very tough time in their lives. And then came Easter morning. Then came the resurrection. When hope rose. When the victory was sure. When the stone was rolled away. When Jesus' lungs filled with air. His body was filled with life. And Jesus stood up and Jesus walked out of that tomb victorious. When Jesus rose again on that first Easter morning. And the verses we looked at in Matthew 28 are talking about that. I want you to look at those verses again with me, please. Matthew 28, starting with verse number 1. It says, at the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. That first day of the week, Sunday morning, first Easter morning, they were going, the ladies there were going to the tomb, to the sepulchre, go there. And then we come to verse number 2. And behold, as they make their way to the tomb, and behold, there was a great earthquake. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and set upon it. That stone that was put in place to make sure that nothing happened, to make sure that no one would take the body, to make sure those in authority trying to make sure that this Jesus guy wouldn't come out of that tomb. That stone was put in place, and then the angel descended and rolled back the stone from the door and set right upon it. Verse 3 goes on to describe this angel. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. Those guards that were guarding the tomb, when the angel descended, when this earthquake took place, when that stone was rolled away, it says that for fear of him, they did shake, they shook in their boots. And then the verse goes on to say, and became as dead men. They fainted. They passed out from the fear of this angel. And we come to verse number 5. And the angel answered and said unto the women, those women who had made their way to the tomb, and now they are there. And the angel begins to speak to the women. The angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. Verse number 6, he is not here, for he is risen as he said. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. Verse number 8. And they departed quickly from the sepulcher with fear and great joy, and did run to bring the disciples word. I titled today's message, the message today for Easter Sunday, I titled it, As He Said. As He Said. Jesus had said on numerous occasions that he would die, that he would be killed, and then he would raise again. Those first verses I read, getting started this morning, spoke of those some of those times. Let me read those verses to you again. It was Matthew chapter 20, verses 17 through 19. It says, And Jesus, going up to Jerusalem, took the 12 disciples apart in the way and said unto them. So one of those trips into Jerusalem, he takes the 12 apart, away from the multitude, away from everything else going on. And he says to them, Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests and to the scribes. And they shall condemn him to death, and shall deliver him to the Gentiles to mock, and to scourge, and to crucify him. And the third day he shall rise again. Jesus had said that. John chapter 2, verse 19. Jesus answered and said unto them, Destroy this temple. And he wasn't talking about the temple there in Jerusalem. He was talking about himself, his body. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Again in Mark chapter 8, verse number 31. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes and be killed, and after 3 days, rise again. Jesus had said exactly what was going to happen, and it all played out exactly as Jesus said it would. It all played out just as he said. He said that he would be betrayed, and he was. He said that he would be crucified, and he was crucified. Jesus said that he would die, and he died there on the cross. And then he also said he would come back to life, and he did that too. And praise God, he is alive today. Those women, those ladies on that first Easter morning found this out. Look again at verses 5 and 6. As they had made their way to the sepulcher. And the angel answered and said unto the women, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. When the Lord Almighty says something, when Jesus says it, he means it, and he always follows through on it. Jesus never fails. Jesus never lets you down. Jesus never disappoints. He does just as he says. Now, it may not be the way we want it. It may not be when we want it. It may not be how we prefer it to be. But his way is perfect. And his timing is perfect. And Jesus' promise is sure. And Jesus always does just as he says. You can believe that. You can count on that. He said he would rise again, and he is risen as he said. Jesus is alive today. And as sure as he sits at the right hand of the Father this morning, you can always count on Jesus to do just as he says he will do. He said he would go to the cross and he would pay the penalty for sin. And he did that. Jesus himself, the Son of God, the Lamb, the spotless Lamb, who had never sinned, goes to the cross as if he had, to pay the penalty for the sin that he had never committed, the sin that you and I have committed. He goes to the cross, willingly going to that cross, willingly being the sacrifice for our sin. He said he would do that, and he did that. Christ, Jesus, who had never done anything wrong, who lived a perfect, sinless life, goes to the cross for our sin. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He said he would do that, and he did that. Jesus said that he would die on that cross. And that is exactly what happened. He suffered and died on that cross. Now, let me make sure you understand this. It was not the cross that killed him. It was not the beatings that killed him. He willingly went to the cross, and Jesus gave up the ghost himself. He died willingly on the cross. He said he would do that, and he did that. And he also said he would raise 3 days later. He did that as well. When Jesus says it, he means it, and he always follows through on it. He always does just as he says. He says he would go to the cross. He did that. He said he would die. He did that. He said he would raise again, and he did that. Jesus also said that he is the way, that he is the truth, that he is the life, and he is all of those things, all three of those things. When Jesus says it, he means it. He follows through on it. He is the way. There is no other way to be saved. There is no other way of salvation. There is no other way to heaven other than through Jesus, through faith in Jesus Christ. He is the way. He is the truth. He wasn't just telling the truth. Jesus is the truth. He is the way. He is the truth. And Jesus is the life. He said that, and he meant. Jesus said, ye must be born again. And here's the good news, you can be. Because of his sacrifice. Because of his death and his resurrection on the cross. Because he gained the victory over sin and over death. He says that you must be forgiven, that you must be born again. And the good news this morning is you can be. If you are not already, you can be. Because of the cross, because of Calvary, because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ, you can be saved. You can be born again. Jesus said it. He said to follow him, and he would make you fishers of men. He said that, and he will do it. He will change your life. He will turn everything around. He will forgive you of your sins. And you begin to follow him and grow in your faith in him and learn to become more like him. And I'm telling you, he will turn it all around. Doesn't mean everything's going to be perfect. Doesn't mean you're not going to go through trials and tribulations and tough times. We're going through some right now. We all know that. But he will turn everything around. He will give you the strength to face anything. He will give you the endurance to get through everything. He will change it all around. He will make all the difference in your life if you put your faith and trust in him and you follow him every single day. He said he would go to the cross. He would die on the cross. He would raise again. He said he is the way, the truth, and the life. He said you must be born again. He said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. He said all of these things. And he also said that he's coming back someday. And he is. Praise God, he is. He will come back one day. No one knows when. Scripture says nobody knows. But we know for a fact, Jesus said it, and he will do it. Jesus is coming back one day. Are you ready for that day? When Jesus says it, he means it. And he always follows through on it. He does just as he says. Not only did Jesus say he would rise again, not only did he say you could be saved and you should follow him, but Jesus also said this. Jesus said that he would build a church. I want you to listen to Matthew chapter 16, verse number 18. Matthew 16, 18. And I say unto thee, this is Jesus speaking. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. Jesus says, I will build my church. And listen to the rest of the verse. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Jesus said that. And when Jesus said something, he means it, and he follows through on it. When Jesus says it, he means it. And Jesus, what he says, if he follows through on. And he said in Matthew 16, 18, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. The church is not this building that I'm standing in right now. The church is not the facilities that surround me right now. The church is not the programs that we have each and every week. The Sunday schools, the Sunday nights, the youth program. It is none of those things. The church is none of those things. The church that Jesus says that he would build is the people. The church is you and I. The church, in the simplest way I can put it, the church is a group of followers of Jesus, of born-again believers. That's what the church is. Where we come together, we love our Heavenly Father, we love one another, and we want to serve others. That's the church. The church is you and I. And it's been that way since the very beginning. And we see in Scripture that the early church faced difficulties. But the early church prevailed. It continued on. The early church was not defeated. We are facing difficulties today. But we will prevail. Jesus said so. As the church, you and I, nothing can stand in our way from accomplishing God's will. Nothing at all. Not the world. Nothing that the world can throw at us will stop us. Not the world, not persecution. We see it all through Scripture. We see it over and over and over again. The persecution of the church. And what is the church? Keep that in mind. It's followers of Jesus. Those groups of people, born-again believers, followers of Jesus, who are persecuted for their faith, but yet the church prevails through Jesus Christ. Nothing can stop us. We will prevail. Nothing can stand in our way from accomplishing God's will. Not the world, not persecution. And let me tell you something, not a virus. It will not stop the church. It may, because of this situation we're in, we may have to adapt and do things a little differently. But let me tell you something. This virus will not prevail against the Lord's church. Not the world, not persecution, not a virus, not the gates of hell, as Jesus said. All the powers of hell, all the powers of the enemy, all the powers of Satan will not prevail against God's people, against the church. Listen to what Jesus said again. He says, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Nothing can prevail against us. Nothing can prevail against the church. Not even the gates of hell, not even death itself. With that in mind, as I think about all this, when we're facing this time that we are in right now, as hard as it is, as difficult as it is, we will prevail against this. We will get through this by the power of Almighty God. We will get through this. And I pray, and I honestly believe this, that we will be stronger as the church on the other side of this. I think that through this time, and through this time of testing, through this time of trials, I think that we are being strengthened in our faith. And I think that we will be stronger in our faith, closer to our Lord Jesus Christ, and closer to one another, and stronger as a church, more love and more unity, with more being more of one accord than ever before on the other side of this. This is not going to get the best of us. We will prevail because of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If God be for us, right? Who can be against us? Or what can be against us? Absolutely nothing. If nothing can stop our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, not those in authority, and not those beatings, and not even the grave, the tomb, or death itself, if that can't stop Him, it can't stop us. The church will prevail. The church will be stronger on the other side of this. Jesus said it. That makes it so. Jesus said He would rise again, and He did. Jesus said He would build a church that the gates of hell should not prevail against, and He did that. We are the church. And Jesus also said this, that His followers would be victorious. 1 Corinthians 15:57. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have the victory over whatever we are facing through our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 8:37. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. Through Him that loved us so much that He went to the cross and died on the cross and then rose again just as He said He would. Through Him, we are more than conquerors. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Now thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ. Always triumph through Christ. If you are saved, if you are born again, if there is that time, that place where you accepted Christ as your Lord and your Savior, if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, stay faithful, stay focused on Him, and the victory is yours. No matter what you're facing, no matter what giant you are facing, no matter what the circumstances are, they cannot get the better of you by the power of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Stay faithful, stay focused. The angel said to the women in Matthew 28, verse 6, He is not here, He is risen, as He said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay. He says, come and see. I hope that you see the Lord is risen today. Now let's go on and look at verse number 7. Verse number 7, the angel says, go quickly and tell His disciples that He is risen from the dead. And behold, He goeth before you into Galilee. There shall you see Him. Lo, I have told you. The angel says to the ladies there, he says to them to go and tell others that Jesus is risen, just as he said he would be. He encourages those ladies to go and to tell others that Jesus is risen. You and I need to do the same thing. We need to tell others that he is risen, just as he said he would be. You and I need to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ to those who need to hear it. You and I need to share with others how we met him. We need to share our story with others. And you and I need to tell them how they can know Jesus as their Savior. Just as somebody told us. We should not be ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Why should we be? It is the best news there is. It is the good news that Christ died for the sinner, that he is alive today, and that you can know him as your Savior. Jesus can change your life. Jesus can change your eternity. In verse number 6, the angel said, he is risen as he said. In verse number 7, the angel says, go share this good news with others. And now we come to verse number 8. It says, and they departed quickly from the sepulcher with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. They saw the tomb that was empty. They saw the stone rolled away. They heard the words of the angel that he is risen as he said he would be. The angel says to them, now go and share this good news with other people. And what did they do? We see in verse 8 that they were obedient. Verse number 8, look at it again. It says, and they departed. They departed. You and I need to share the gospel message with others. And we need to get to work. We need to get going on this. We don't need to drag our feet on this. We need to be obedient as these women were on that very first Easter morning as they were instructed to go. And it says they departed. They were obedient. You and I need to be obedient to God's will in our lives. God always blesses obedience. God's will is always perfect. And so it would do us well to be obedient to his perfect will. Those ladies were obedient. We see it says that in verse number 8, they departed. And then we also see that they did not hesitate. They departed. And how did they depart? They departed quickly. They did not hesitate. They did it right away. They did not drag their feet. They did not come up with excuses. They did not let anything hold them back. And I'm telling you, so often in our lives, the excuses come so easily. Well, I know I should be doing this, and I know I should do that, and I know God kind of wants me to do this, but listen, God's will is perfect. And if God wants you to do it, do it. And do it quickly. Don't hesitate. Don't drag your feet. It says that the ladies, as instructed by the angel, says they departed quickly from the sepulcher. That is verse number 8. So they departed quickly from the sepulcher. And how did they depart? Not only did they do it quickly, but look what the verse says. They did this with fear and great joy. They were obedient, they didn't hesitate, and they were fulfilled as they departed quickly to share the good news of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They were fulfilled. It says that they left with fear and great joy. Now that word fear doesn't mean that they were scared, they were shaken like somebody jumped out from underneath behind a tree and scared them. Like, it's not like that at all. What that means is that they were filled with fear or reverence of God, respect for God. They were in awe of the Savior, the risen Savior. They did that with fear and great joy. in their lives. They were fulfilled. And who doesn't want that? Who doesn't want to be fulfilled? Who doesn't want to have great joy? Not just joy, but great joy. Who doesn't want to have that? Who doesn't want to have peace in their lives? A peace that passes all understanding. Who doesn't want that? Who doesn't want to be backed by Almighty God, knowing that He's going to give us the strength to get through whatever, knowing that nothing can prevail against us, knowing that nothing can stand in our way? Who doesn't want that in their lives? Who doesn't want that kind of victory? Who doesn't want that kind of boldness? They departed quickly from the sepulcher with fear and great joy, and did run to bring His disciples word. We need to get to work. Jesus always does as He said He would. We should share this good news with others of the risen Savior and the victory that they can have through Him and salvation that they can have through Him. We should share that good news with others, and it's fulfilling. When we do this, it is life-changing when we are obedient to do this. It is life-changing for others. It is life-changing for ourselves. This can change eternities where someone will spend eternity. We should be obedient to God. It is fulfilling when we do. The tomb was empty that first Easter morning. It is still empty today. Jesus was alive then. He is alive today. And He will be forever. just as he said he would be. I want to end this morning. I couldn't think of any more fitting verses to end today than John 3:16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent his Son into the world. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Jesus is alive today. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He will save you if you believe, if you repent, you call upon his name, and he will reign forever, and you can be with him forever. Let's bow before the Lord in prayer as we close today. Father, we humbly bow before you. We give you honor, we give you glory that you so loved the world, that you so loved us, that you would send your only begotten Son to be born in a manger, to live a perfect, sinless life, to go to a cross, not because he deserved it, not because of anything that he had done, but because of what we have done. And for him to hang there on that cross, to take the penalty, to pay the price for our sin. Lord, words fail. That is so humbling. But that was your will. That's what Jesus did. And he died on that cross. They put his body in the tomb. And 3 days later, he walked victoriously out of that tomb, having the victory over sin, having the victory over death, paving the way so that we could be saved, that we could be reconciled with you, that we could be born again, that we could be washed of our sins and become new creatures in your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you and praise you for that. For those listening today who are saved, I pray a word of encouragement, a prayer of encouragement to them. I pray that they take comfort and peace, knowing for a fact that when your Son Jesus said it, he always did just as he said, and he still does. He always follows through. And for Lord, if there's anyone listening here who may not be saved, I pray, Lord, as they have listened to the promises of your word, the promises of your Son, Lord, of your great love and of the tremendous sacrifice and of the glorious resurrection, Lord, I pray that they would ponder where they stand with you, their relationship with you, where they will spend eternity. And Lord, I pray that you would, send someone to tell them the gospel message. I pray that they would reach out to someone that they know can tell them about salvation. And Lord, I pray that even though we're going through a tough time right now, that I pray that souls would be saved through this. I pray that eternities would be changed, and I pray that you would be glorified through this. And Lord, I'm trusting that the church will grow and become even stronger on the other side of this. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your love for us. We thank you for your Son, Jesus. We pray this in his name. Amen. Say one last time, Happy Easter to everybody. May God bless each and every one of you. May you be filled with hope, because Jesus is alive today. Love y'all, miss y'all. Happy Easter. I'll see y'all soon.